So as we approach doing our practice, our usual sitting practice, a moment to reflect on what a simple practice as we do, simply paying attention to our breath, paying attention to the sound emanating from our chest. And we enter this practice with this gentle sense that may it be a benefit. So right there, we're not just collapsed into some kind of very, very narrow sense of what we're doing. We have a sense that it is our intention, our wish, and there is every possibility that actually by sitting here, being with ourselves, being together this morning, cultivating some attention, relaxing our usual sort of pattern of rushing about and being totally engaged in worry. Worry might come, but we won't be totally engaged in it because when we notice that we've gone into worry or distraction, we'll gently remind ourselves, we'll have a critical moment, as Sharon said yesterday, a critical moment really of awakening. Oh, I've become distracted. Let me go back to my breath. It's a very, very fruitful moment of great portent, actually, because it means that we're coming into the present, which is actually all we ever have. And we are doing it with a gentle intention that this be really beneficial. We recognize, in fact, that it is beneficial for ourselves. There are many, many studies, some of you may be aware, studies of people who have been cultivating attention, cultivating compassion, and things like stress levels go down, cortisone production in the body, which is actually very corrosive of health, begin to be reduced, immunity goes up, the vagus nerve is healthier, which is what connects the heart with the brain area and has many, many significant outcomes for the body. So actually, it's not just imagination. There is something positive that comes, but not just for us. When we are less stressful, when we are more present, when we are more engaged and alive, actually, then naturally we have something more to bring to others. Do you like being around someone who's relaxed and looking at you in a calm and receptive way? Or do you like being around somebody who's constantly reaching for their iPhone and their eyes darting back and forth to see whom else might be coming into view? What's more pleasurable for you? What makes you feel more like you are connecting with somebody that you want to connect to? How does it feel in your body when you yourself are relaxed and offering of generous attention in that way? How does it feel in your body when you are receiving that from someone else? It's just kind of nice. We feel heard, we feel seen, and these are actually psychologically, in terms of psychological health, very significant. So what is something very simple that we're doing has tremendous potential, tremendous, and great effect right in the moment. So we recognize this by, as we always open, as we'll do in a moment, saying, opening with the aspiration, may all beings have happiness and its causes. That's really why I'm sitting here, to grow happiness. May all beings be free of suffering and its causes. That's why I'm sitting here, to reduce suffering, my own and others. Are you in a better position to be of some resourcefulness to others' pain if you are totally distracted and self-obsessed? You know the answer to that. And yet it's not so easy to get out of that habit because me, 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 I have a lot of issues. Requires a lot of my attention. So in the first, we call this the first sacred aspect or the first intrinsic excellence of our practice. We take a moment to really acknowledge and aspire to the benefit that comes from our practice. That's the first thing. And then completely related with that is the recognition that if I'm totally self-obsessed and worried about what I'm going to do tonight and what I did yesterday and how somebody else did this to me and I'm going to do something back to them, you know, this kind of very, very familiar treadmill, then what happens that we can notice also is that our energy, the domain of our attention becomes kind of more and more constricted and more tight and more self-involved and like a ball of yarn winding around itself more and more and more and more and more and more. It's all about me, and you know, we've got holding this tight kind of thing of me-ness, selfie-ness. You know, we're always taking selfies actually internally. Click, 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 this is how I feel. And we're taking otheries also, you know, this is how they are, this is how they are, and their otheriness doesn't agree with my selfiness, and that's kind of the beginning of all of our difficulties in this world. So the second thing that we can recognize and just appreciate, it's not really doing something about it, but we can appreciate that as we sit and observe our attention, settle our attention on our breath and our bodies, we're in a very natural way, just by the fact of our relaxing and opening our attention, we are beginning to unwind a little bit. We're beginning to devolve a little bit this kind of very, very involved, obsessive, kind of frenetic, even worried stuckness onto something, me, this very small thing, which is inevitably different from everybody else, and which, if we get too fastened on it, when we get too fastened on it, it will interfere with the flow of our good intentionality to benefit all beings. And then, so that's the second sacred point, that we're loosening up a little bit. That's a portal to wisdom, to realizing our own nature, what we really are, because we really aren't this very constricted, a knotted up ball of yarn. We're really not. And so by allowing our attention to rest, we begin to relax that a little bit. We form a foundation for exploring that wisdom portal more and more and more. And then the third sacred aspect, when we close, in a sense, we complete the circle where we began. We share, we dedicate, we send out to the whole universe the goodness of our practice, and that is in our dedication. So I just want to mention these three excellences, the tambasum, sometimes called the three sacred aspects of our practice, that we begin with an orientation to be of benefit to ourselves, to everyone, that we proceed with an acknowledgement that what we're doing is a path to relaxing this sort of obsessive me-me-me-ness that really narrows and constricts our whole world and all our behavior. And then we close again with having relaxed that, even more capacity to open up and share and resolve that what we do, what we bring to the world, to our lives, to our families, to this afternoon, from this practice, this also of benefit to everyone. So those three excellence aspects of our practice.
Would you clarify the book, dear, going around?
The book. It went around already.
The book went around?
I think, did two go around? Uh-oh.
There are two books?
There's another one going around now that already went around.
Well, why don't you just say what it's about?
Hi. how many of you are here for the first time? Welcome. Welcome. Great day to be here with the Texans at our side. Thank you for coming. And the book that is going around, we call it our Book of Names. And at the end, when we do dedicate and we share our practice with everyone, we also share it specifically and name persons near and dear to us or ourselves who we feel are in need of special sending of our good wishes. So we'll read the names in the book at the end, and that's what that book is. Okay. Umzila. So we'll begin. She'll tell you.
Start with the two aspiration prayers on this sheet.
Do you need a microphone? Could Claire have a microphone?
So this is the two aspiration prayers on the yellow sheet. May all beings always have happiness and its causes. May all beings always be free of pain and its causes. For as long as space abides, as long as the world remains, just so long may I be there, resolving all beings' pain.
And being present is very much a function of being at ease, being deeply relaxed, and feeling deeply supported. So we always take a moment to notice the sense of contact between the bottom of your body and your cushion. And just noticing that brings you into the present. It's that simple. And feel the solidity and actual physical support coming from your seat. You really are being held. You really can trust that if you relax into your seat, your support, it will in fact hold you. You won't sink through the floor. And that sense of being supported is quite important for us. It helps us relax. It helps us develop trust in an embodied sense. It helps us open to love, both offering and receiving it. And so feeling the contact of your cushion or your chair, just feel it. You don't have to think about it, not at all. Just sense into it, because sensing into our experience is actually a very crucial aspect of our practice. It's very simple. But often we feel we have to do something more. We have to think about it or evaluate it or make it better or change it in some way, or somebody else doing it better than we are. But none of that. We just sense it. That's all. Sensing your body is being in the present. Being in the present is being alive to what is. Being alive to what is brings you right into the center of your own life. And being settled in this way, you can feel that there's a natural kind of alignment supporting you from within, an additional support that we can notice from the bottom of your spine to the center of your belly, your heart, your throat, your crown. Just naturally, there actually is central access in your body. And when we are aligned in this way, it offers a support such that it makes it easier to relax from our shoulders, like silk draped over a hanger. It's just held, it's just present there. So you can notice if your shoulders are a little tense and just see if just acknowledging that tension perhaps will release it a little bit. Can't make yourself relax, but you can be aware and that will bring relaxation. And with this alignment in place, your breath flows all the more smoothly. And we gently direct our attention to our breath so that we can feel it. That's all. Practice is very simple. Being in the present is very simple. Resting your attention on your breath. And as your breath flows in, your attention comes with it. And you just are alive to the experience of this freshness, this absolutely life-giving air that is coming in right now, energy that is coming in right now in its purest possible form. And then when it has offered itself to you, of course, we exhale. You feel the sensation of relaxation that goes along with exhalation. And if you're new to this practice, just watch your breath wherever it's most apparent to you, perhaps in the opening and relaxation of your chest area, or drop down into your belly. If your mind is very quiet, you might feel it over the top of your lip. Doesn't matter. Just sense whatever you sense with your breath. We'll do this together for several minutes. And this is really a no-worry practice. Either your mind, your attention is with your experience of your breath, or you notice that it isn't, in which case you are awake and you bring it back to your breath. And gathering your attention now in the center of your body, your heart. We sound the gathering sound, hong, hong, as we exhale. And letting our awareness be completely with the unification of breath and sound and attention. And this is another way of gathering and strengthening our capacity for being in the present. Sound like a body. Sound is always in the present. Oh. Oh. And one gentle awe sealing into space your good aspirations for the benefit of all. And now we'll have a short break. You can bring your same flowing attention to enjoying the snacks or to talking with each other. And then we'll come back and close with being present again and our dedication for everyone. Let me just take one moment to see if you have a question about this practice, because we'd like you to take it home with you. Okay. Karen.
Thank you. Could you say a little about the hung sound? And I get a little confused on how to pronounce it, because I don't know if it's om or hung or hung. Or and when you say it's a gathering sound, what? It's a sacred syllable. I know I've heard that. Mm-hmm, but mm-hmm, if you mm-hmm, could say a little mm-hmm, bit more about mm-hmm, that, it would mm-hmm. might ease some confusion.
Okay, you're saying it perfectly, hung, so no worries there. It does sound different from om. Sometimes we use the om also, but that's om. This is hung. So it's a sacred syllable, as you said, and it's described as a gathering sound because it just has this quality of bringing us into our presence and being. Whereas ah is kind of an open, all-inclusive sound, and that's why we use it sometimes for very short dedication. And then when we really close, we'll do more elaborate dedication. And it's actually the heart syllable of many, many of the enlightened beings around the room and throughout space. Hung. Well, ah too, but hung is always here. Ah is when it's in the body is here, but also we do practice. Sometimes it's here. Don't worry about it. So we're doing hung, and it is a very ancient use, and thus a blessed syllable, and actually directly transmitted to us by our teacher in Tibet, Adzen Rinpoche, so that everybody here could enjoy it. Very simple and full of potential. Okay, so have a little break of snacks and come back.
I ask precious three gems from deep in my pained heart.
Break cinema.
See me with compassion.
Yeah.
I have no other hope. This dear human body, impermanence besets. Do you not fear your death, good and faithful student? The five skandhas gather and disperse who knows when. Heartily think on death, good and faithful student. Karma never deceives, so give up wrongful thoughts engage Dharma holy. I ask precious three gems from deep in my pained heart. See me with compassion. I have no other hope. This dear human body, impermanence besets. Do you not fear your death, good and faithful student? The five skandhas gather and disperse who knows when. Heartily think on death, good and faithful student. Karma never deceives, so give up wrongful thoughts. Engage Dharma holy. I ask precious three gems from deep in my pained heart. See me with compassion. I have no other hope. This dear human body, impermanence besets. Do you not fear your death, good and faithful student? The five skandhas gather and disperse who knows when. Heartily think on death, good and faithful student. Karma never deceives, so give up wrongful thoughts. Engage Dharma wholly. I ask precious three gems from deep in my pained heart. See me with compassion. I have no other hope. This dear human body, impermanence besets. Do you not fear your death, good and faithful student? The five skandhas gather and disperse who knows when. Heartily think on death, good and faithful student. Karma never deceives, so give up wrongful thoughts. Engage Dharma wholly.
Kamilte mita to bole.
I ask precious three gems from deep in my pained heart. See me with compassion. I have no other hope. This dear human body, impermanence besets. Do you not fear your death, good and faithful student? The five skandhas gather and disperse who knows when. Heartily think on death, good and faithful student.
Dawn Mountain offers traditional Buddhist teachings, primarily in the Tibetan tradition, in a way that is accessible to contemporary Americans. Having studied and practiced for many years under recognized Tibetan masters, and understanding that these teachings provide a way to realize the natural state of mind that embodies profound wisdom and deep love, Anne Klein and Harvey Aronson wish to share these traditions here in the United States. As a result, they established Dawn Mountain in June 1996, based on the core belief that it is possible to cultivate a better understanding of our deepest nature, which in turn facilitates new levels of mental calm and self-acceptance.
So our inspiration really comes from our love and gratitude to our own teachers. They spent so much time and care with us over many, many years.
Ketsen Rinpoche was extraordinarily compassionate. He had a terrific sense of humor. His ability to be present and immediate.
Well, this, I think, is the
and
I think most people have written in there.
Just there. Adzom Rinpoche is extraordinarily compassionate and grounded.
And we've had extraordinary experiences with Adzom Rinpoche, whom I met in Tibet in 96. And I had many hours of just one-on-one conversation, a person who has tens of thousands of students to attend to. Mm. Okay, there's this wealth of cultural... So we'll...
I'm going to...
I know. Okay.
What?
I was going to say, so we'll go back to our meditative being, not that it's ever gone, and Harvey will lead the closing meditation, And then we'll do our regular dedication. And Janet, when we get to it, would you light the candle? Thank you.
So we'll close with a kind of meditation like we did yesterday at the Rothko Chapel. Very, very simple meditation on love. So just be in a meditative posture and be relaxed. You know, we just wish ourselves to begin with, may I be at ease, may I be at peace, may I be without any tension or contraction. May I be free from obstacles. May I be at ease. May I be happy. May everyone in this room be at ease. May we have the sources of happiness. May we get in touch with our innate sources of happiness. May we all be at peace. May all in our surroundings be happy. May all be at ease. May all be free from all obstructedness. May all beings be in touch with their innate sources of peace and happiness. May all beings be at ease. And may all be free from suffering. May we all be in touch with our innate sources of wisdom and happiness. May we all be happy, at peace. May all beings be at ease. May all beings be at ease. May all beings be at ease. And just let yourself be whatever is occurring. Just allow yourself to be without fussing with yourself. Just being. Not working, not doing, just being. So going back to what Ann said, what we do at the end of any positive activity, we not only hold on to that positivity for ourselves, we like to share that with all beings. So we do that with our dedication, and then we have a little blessing that we do, and then we call our dear and close and all beings to mind with the reading of the book. So, Claire, could you lead the
names before the blessing prayer?
Names before or names after?
After. So we'll start with the dedication on this sheet.
By this good may I swiftly once become a great guru, lead all beings, everyone, to reach to that very ground.
The blessing.
With all of you in mind, we light this lamp of clarity. May the glow of love wisdom shine within us, everyone, till we all rise forth born in one enlightened mandala.
So we have a tradition today of two books.
Which will end today, we hope. one book.
I think it must have started here, no?
No, I wrote there. Start?
That's Sunday 24.
Oh, maybe I'm the only one who wrote this book.
Yeah.
Because I thought it was...
Okay.
Okay.
Jennifer in 3 month retreat, Gloria in 3 year retreat, Pat Macon, Steve Tainer, Vajra the dog, Margarita in retreat, Kathy Kerr, Brooke, Deanna and family.
Ken, Lori, Deborah, Jessica, Coco, Casper, Alice, Mary in the Bardo, Tessa, Annie, Monica and her grandmother, Ellen and Anya, Somsnira, Che, Mom and Dad, Suzanne's mom in the Bardo, Kevin and Dow, Teresa Sherson, Lawrence Sherson, Joan Parker, David Sherson, Ernesto Fontenla, Susanna, Miriam, Jerry, John Sill, Ann, Natalie, Mary in the Bardo, David, Edward, Diane, Bill, and Joe in the Bardo, Cheryl, Kathy, Catherine, Sam, Albert, Glenn and Margaret, Rachel, Tracy or Tacy, Amarty, Chris and Natasha and kids, George, Helen, Andrea and Kurt, Eleanor Day, Daniel, Seth, Susan, Robin, Karen, Jamie, Eddie, Robin, Darlene, Aaron, Natalia, Tom Brunson in the Bardo.
Do you want to do the concluding?
Okay, you can do it.
So, as Anne said, we conclude with an which is really both a resonating with our innermost nature and also a offering of kindness and good wishes to all.
So we thank you for coming and remind you that meditation is fostered by practice. So encourage you very much to set apart a little bit of your day, even a little bit, and be with your breath, be with your heart, and cultivate practices that you are familiar with, practice that we did here, breathing, hong, it will express itself in your being and in your life. It's been proven to change the brain in positive ways. So I encourage you to do that. And meditation is also fostered by some learning, understanding more about what we are doing, different aspects of meditation. And this period in the fall on our teaching Tuesdays, first and third Tuesdays, we're focusing on love and compassion as part of what are the four boundless states. Love and compassion can be developed limitlessly. That's actually our goal. It might sound scary right now, but that's actually what we're seeking to inquire into, at least. And our next teaching Tuesday is November 7th, and it's, I mean, I never do this right. There's some brain cell missing. Anyway, yes, I was so proud I was going to get the number right. I got the month wrong. Anyway, luckily there are other brighter people around, so we always end up. So October 7th, Gelsey Rinpoche from Nepal is coming, and we've asked him to teach this same topic, love and compassion, from a text that's never been taught in the West before, as far as we know. It's something that we're actually translating as part of the Dawn Mountain translation team. I think you'll enjoy it. It's very famous for its expression of these foundational teachings that love and compassion are foundational for everything else. So we invite you. That's a special week for us because he's actually going to speak on Tuesday and Wednesday night. He's only here those 2 days. And then other Tibetan visitors are coming up later in the fall. And other than that, on Teaching Tuesdays, Harvey and I are teaching.
Yes, October 25th from 1 to 5, Tuku Jigme, who's the grandson of our founding teacher, Kitsun Sangbo, will be here teaching also about love and compassion. This is love and compassion fall, and we can't get enough of it. And it's really good to get different perspectives, different teachers. So you're all welcome to come to these events.
Did you have an announcement?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Sure.
So I'm actually going to be teaching a couple of meditation courses here. Nothing at Dawn Mountain, unfortunately, in the fall, but sorry. but starting actually this Monday at the Jung Center, I'll be teaching a 4-week course on, surprisingly, compassion. and then sometime in October, there will be a 6-week course starting at the Rothko that's going to be more mindfulness, but kind of like mindfulness infused by love and compassion, some joy and equanimity too. There are little flyers about the Rothko one out there, or you can see the Jung Center website for that one.
Thank you so much. Huh?
Practice Tuesdays.
We also have Practice Tuesdays. Once you've learned a little bit of practice here, do you want to say something about that? Are you meeting this Tuesday?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
We meet each third and fourth Tuesday of each month. Second and fourth Tuesday of
it's
each
catching.
Month. And we are here from 6:30 to...
They're still doing it, she said. This is a fifth Tuesday, but you're going to meet this Tuesday.
Oh, fifth Tuesday.
Yeah.
We don't have anyone
scheduled. No,
schedules.
We don't have it scheduled. We'll let it go because also we have so much coming up the following week.
Uh-huh.
But to the point, second and fourth Tuesdays are practice time.
Yes, second and fourth Tuesday from 6:30 to 7:45. And each person can practice whatever practice they are doing they'd like to concentrate on at that time. What we do is we have 10 minutes intervals of practice and we stop for around a minute and keep on going. So it's really a great time to really be together and just practice together. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for helping sustain it. Mary Scott.
good morning. And on
you may have noticed if you've been practicing with us on Sundays, we've had the pitter-patter of little feet for the past 5 weeks, but this is the concluding day of mindful discovery for 8 to 12-year-olds. So they met today in the Japanese garden at Herman Park to practice mindfulness in nature. And on Sunday, October 12th, we will start our Kind Mind, Happy Life program for 4 to 8-year-olds. We've already got several folks signed up for that. So if you're interested or know some interested 4 to 8-year-olds, get them over here. Simone Wittich, who's our education director, is absolutely fantastic. And if anybody has questions about that, be happy to talk after.
Thank you.
Do you want to say something more?
Oh, sure. this is your first time with Don Myung. This is not the final form of this room, we hope. Much as we like the garage door, conversations at the football park are going by. We are hoping to begin renovations in this space very, very soon. We have a little plan if you're interested in looking at it. And as always at Don Mountain, we are supported by the generous donations of people who belong to us and come to see us. If anybody is interested in becoming a member, we'd love to talk with you about that. And we have a Red Bull, as always, for donations on your way out. Thank you in advance for your generous support.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, everyone.
Braving the Texans traffic.
Have a great rest of your day.